Remember, 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 there is a friend.
Check, check. 1, 2, oh, I love him. 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Oh, come on and worship with me. Say it, come on.
Oh, my God, that I can.
Don't you give up. I know.
I know that I can stand.
Hang on,
check, check. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. With him, I know I can take it. With him, I know. I feel like having some church in here. No matter what may come. Yeah. Jesus, my life is in.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Every person that's going through, lift your hands and say it with me.
Eight.
I know I can.
Love.
I got a witness in here somewhere. I know. No matter what may come my way. So much, Jesus. With you, I know I can.
Jesus, I can.
Oh, bless your name, Jesus.
With him, I know I can.
No matter what may come my way.
No matter what
hallelujah.
May come my way.
Hey, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12.
I know you can.
I know.
Check, check.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Woo! To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power.
Come on. You declare it.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
There is power.
There is power
in the name.
In the name of Jesus.
We know where it is to break every chain.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Lord, we know we can depend on you whenever we need you. And we are calling on your strength right now. Right now. Thank you, Father, for answered prayers. And that was a prayer. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. The announcements are as follows. Again, if you don't have a bulletin, just do know that the youth choir rehearsals will start again in August, and the adult choir rehearsals will continue to be at Saturdays at noon. Bible studies will be held on Wednesdays at noon, and you are really invited to come out and join in. Thirsty Thursday Bible studies. Thirsty Thursday will resume on August the 3rd. Okay. Don't forget to visit us on the web. Okay. Sometimes you may have a problem just getting sbclove.com. Try ssbclove.com. It worked for me. The new discipleship class is ongoing. And again, just feel free to just come on in. Come on down. Calling all members of Sunnyside. Now, just be aware that on the third Saturday, Sunnyside tends to prepare and pass out food to the community. But on that Friday, they're asking for people to come out and package it so that it will be ready to be distributed. So again, you're invited to come out on that Friday as well as the third Saturday. And local businesses, feel free to give the church a call. Okay, just in case you may have something you may want to share, perhaps in the foyer. All right. If you were not here last week, you missed a tremendous blessing. A tremendous blessing. Our kids showed up and they showed out. Amen. But our kids could not have done it had it not been for the adults that was really working and guiding them. So again, we just thank you for that tremendous blessing. As you look on the pulpit, you'll notice that one of our members is no longer with us. And again, yes, Pat, it is gonna be a difficult day, but the Lord answers prayers. And we are lifting the family of Shirley Mitchell up. Okay, because she was a part of our family and truly loved. Truly loved. Truly loved. Truly loved. And I do know that the hardest thing that was for me when my mother passed was when people would come up to me and they had tears all in their eyes. I understand it's hard for you, but it's even harder for the family. So get yourself together before you even attempt to speak to them, okay? That's something I actually stared the minister down who was trying to make my family cry. Oh, no, 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 you just don't do that. Again, we love you, and we're just so thankful to just see you here because her love just continues. Thank you so much. Praise the Lord.
Ready, begin. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem, for a day in thy courts is better than a thousand. I had rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of wickedness. Amen, 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 amen. This is the place to be, amen, in the house of the Lord. Where we can find refuge, where we can find hope, where we can find healing. I always say, or I've been saying, I don't know if I've always said it, but you see us up here doing what we do, but just because we're doing what we do, just because you're doing what you do, doesn't mean that you're not going through, amen?
But God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we could ever ask or think or imagine. Amen. Because greater is he that is in us than he that is in the world. And we just have to call on the name of the Lord and allow him to be who we said he is. Amen. 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 So this first praise song that we're going to sing is a song that Shirley sang. She led this song. So come on and praise the Lord with me. To the going down of the same, he is yet worthy to be praised. Blessed Savior, he's worthy worthy to be praised.
Good morning, Sunnyside.
Good morning.
My name is Deacon Glover. I have the honor to read the Word of God. It's short and sweet. It comes from the book of Genesis, the first chapter, 26 through 27, and it's New Living Translation. And it reads as follows. Then God said, "Let us make human beings in our own image to be like us. that will reign over the fish in the sea, the birds in the sky, the livestock and all the wild animals on the earth, and the small animals that scurry along the ground. So God created human beings in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. And may God bless the hearers, readers, doers, preachers, and teachers of his word, and let the church say,
amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. You all can have a seat if you'd like. This next song is Just Be Grateful. The Bible says that all things work together for the good. Doesn't say that all things are good. And right now, we are hurting. We are sad. But even in the midst of that, we are yet grateful to the God who so loved us that he allowed Shirley Mitchell to be in our presence, to be on this earth for 68 years. And for that, we are grateful.
Be grateful.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Good morning, Sunnyside. It's prayer time. We have a lot to be grateful for. In spite of, we still have a lot to be grateful for. Let us bow our heads in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, lifting you up as always, Lord, giving you all the praise and all the glory, Lord, because you're so deserving of all of our praise. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for just being God all by yourself. Well, Heavenly Father, you are the Lord of lords and the King of kings. And we praise you this morning, Lord. We give you the highest praise. We shout hallelujah. Hallelujah. And thank you, Lord. Heavenly Father, I come right now in the name of Jesus, Lord, just thanking you, Lord. I thank you for this day, Lord. I recognize, Lord, that this is the day that you have made, and I will rejoice and be glad in it. Lord, I thank you for allowing us to gather here this morning in your sanctuary. Lord, I praise your holy name, Lord, that you've allowed us to wake up this day, Lord, and to see this day and to come and praise you, Lord. Oh, Lord, in spite of what's going on around us, Lord, and what has happened to some of us, Lord, we still want to praise you and thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you've allowed us to gather here this morning. We welcome the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. Holy Spirit, come have your way. Holy Spirit, give us our words. Give us our song, Lord. Give us our thoughts. We need you this morning like we need you every day, Lord. So we just thank you, Lord. Lord, I pray right now for the under-shepherd of this house, Lord. I pray for my pastor, Lord. Oh, Heavenly Father, he doesn't want to be recognized because he knows he has joy to have in heaven. But, Lord, I want to thank you for him right now, Lord. I thank you for the 9 years that he has followed you, Lord, and to done what you have done. Last Sunday, Lord, was a glimpse of what he has tried to do, Lord, by your lead, Lord. And we praise you. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for the ministers and the chairpersons and the directors of the youth, Lord, that worked so hard, and all the workers that worked so hard with our youth, Lord, because the pastor got that word years ago, Lord, that God wanted him to work in this community and work for the young people. And he has tried to do that, Lord, and last Sunday was a glimpse of some of the success. So we praise you and we thank you for that, Lord. Lord, I thank you, Lord, that you've allowed us to gather here, Lord. It is a sad time for some of us, Lord, but we know because you're God, things are still going to be all right, Lord. So we praise you and we thank you that you allowed Shirley Mitchell to come this way, Lord. Oh, what a blessing she was, Lord, for this church and for those who knew her. We thank you right now, Lord. We're grateful and we thank you, Lord, for her life that she led, Lord. Oh, Lord, she was an angel right here helping us in this church, Lord, and we thank you so much, Lord. We pray for her family right now. We pray for all of the children, all of the grandchildren, all of the relatives, all of the sisters and the cousins and her close friend, Lord, who was like a sister to her. We ask that you would strengthen them right now, Lord, and lift them up and be with them in a mighty way. Now, Heavenly Father, I praise you right now, Lord, for the musicians of our church who have played songs, Lord, playing like David played, Lord. We thank you for our choir that sings like angels, Lord. And right now, I pray for the speaker of the hour. I pray right now, Lord, that you would allow Reverend Sims to go down into the deep treasures of your word, Lord. Give her the power this morning that she needs, Lord, to preach the word that you have put on her heart and her mind, Lord. Oh, Lord, give us our ears right now, Lord, so that we can hear the word. Give us our hearts, Lord, so we can accept the word, Lord, because we need you right now more than we need you before. Oh, Lord, we're going to continue to give you the praise and the glory and bless you, Lord, and just thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Good morning, church. It is now time for tithes and offering. Please stand and join me. I'm reading the offertory scripture, since it's taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, 6-8. Ready? Begin. Remember this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. Whoever sows generously will also reap generously. Each man should give what is decided in his heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that in all things, at all times, you will abound in every good work. Would everyone please remain standing, face the wall, follow the instructions of the ushers. Let us pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to give back to you a portion of what you have blessed us with. Bless those who had to give and those who had not to give. We pray that you'll bless this offering and use it for the building of your kingdom. You are on earth. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So our last song for this morning service is Grateful. We're just wanting to the Lord to know, for God to know that we are yet grateful for all the things that he has done. He is the same God on the mountaintop as he is in the valley low. Amen. Amen. So we just have to call on the name of the Lord and be grateful. Praise you, Lord.
Gratitude is a choice. Gratitude is a choice.
Yes, it is.
I don't think you heard me. Gratitude is a choice. God's not going to do it for us. It is in moments like this, whatever your this is, that you slow down long enough to say, gratitude is a choice. And I used to say, if I just think back over my life, and I consider who you've been, God, when we consider who you've been, Lord, we choose to have hearts of gratitude. Holy Spirit, do what only you can do. We can't manufacture church. We can't manufacture a sermon. We can't manufacture your presence, God. But this morning, we pray that you would breathe on us, Holy Spirit. Guys, I'm not a singer, but as I was sitting in that chair, I'm a worshiper. And the song that came to me, y'all can edit this out later, but I can't preach unless the Holy Spirit does something. And the words that came to my mind as I was sitting there and preparing in the prayer for us this morning is simply, God, breathe on us. And I'm reminded of a song that simply says, breathe on me, power of God, come in and change me. If you know the song, just sing it. You are all I Holy Spirit, sing with me. Breathe on me. Those are the words. Just sing it with me one more time. It says, breathe on me. Power of God. Power of God. Come in, do something in my heart, and change me. You are all I need. You are all I need. Plead with God. Holy Spirit. Breathe on us, God. Breathe on. Talk to him like you know him. In the depths of your heart.
Breathe on me.
If God doesn't do it, it can't happen. Power of God, come in and change me. Change my mindset, God. Change my heart, God. Change my disposition this morning, God. Change my broken spirit, God. Change my way down attitude, God. Change everything that's happening in this atmosphere, God. Because if you don't do it, Holy Spirit, it cannot be done. You are power. You are comfort. You are truth. You are love. You are the very essence that we need. You are the breath in our lungs, God. You are the ruah breath in our lungs, God. If it isn't for your breath, God, in our lungs, God, we couldn't make it, God. So we declare this morning, it is your breath in my lungs. So we say thank you. Breathe on us, God. Fresh wind of your anointing, Holy Spirit. Teach us this morning. Give us a word from your throne, and we'll be grateful for it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All I can hear God is just saying, breathe on me, breathe on me, breathe on me, God, breathe on me. It is the fresh breath of God that gives us the strength to carry on. It is the fresh breath of God in the form of the Holy Spirit that gives us what we need to keep on keeping on. You know, do it, Jesus. He answers prayers. I'm going to preach. I'm going to teach this morning. Okay? You know, I'm going to teach this morning. I promise you guys, I got notes. God been speaking to me this week. So I'm going to share a word. But it has been a rough week in more than one way. But I want to tell you this, because it put a smile on my face. And I know many of us were grieving, but we need the joy of the Lord this morning as well, right? The Bible says the joy of the Lord is your strength, which suggests that it would need to show up in times of weakness, okay? Say, joy shows up on the scene to be strength in times of weakness. So if you're feeling weak this morning, I got good news for you. The joy of the Lord is your strength. So we need strength from God this morning. I love my discipleship class. It's not my discipleship class. It's God's discipleship class. But if you're in discipleship class, can I get like a whoop, whoop? Like throw your hands in the air real quick, right? You're missing out if you're not in 10 a.m. discipleship class every Sunday morning in the conference room. We kind of packed out, but we'll make room for everybody. We make room for everybody. And it put a smile on my face this morning. I thought to myself, the last thing that Miss Shirley said to me 2 weeks ago was, I love homework. You get to do all the homework, Miss Shirley, or all the home rest that you want to do this morning. I'm grateful because she gets to do home rest. But guys, we got homework. We got homework to do. As long as we still in this earth and there's breath in our lungs, Miss Shirley get to do home rest, but baby, we got some home work to do. So if you would turn with me to Genesis chapter 1 this morning. So if you're in our discipleship class, which is like a fourth of the church this morning, but if you're in our discipleship class, this may be a little bit of a refresher for you, but just work with us. Work with me this morning, because God put this word on my heart. I want to teach a little bit. Is that okay? I love preaching, but this morning I want to teach a little bit. So in our discipleship class, we've begun this study on the names of God. And I've mentioned this before in a previous sermon. But see, okay, so a lot of times when the names of God are talked about or preached about or shared about in a church context or even in a Bible study or anything like that, it is presented from the context as if every name of God in the Bible is revealed by God. Right? So it's like, it's God's name because God says it's God's name. But that's not the truth. Some names in the Bible, we've talked about this before, are revealed by God because God is communicating an aspect of who God is, God's nature, God's character, God's personality. Y'all working with me? Y'all were in the back, though. Are y'all working? Y'all with me? Okay. And then there are other names of God. For example, David says, the Lord is my shepherd, right? Sometimes there are names of God that are revealed as a reflection of an encounter or an experience that somebody else had with God. And as an encounter, an experience that they had with God, they name God based on how that changed them, how that impacted them, how their experience with God caused them to see God. I'm not gonna go on to that this morning. I talked about this in another sermon. So for example, I may say, God is my coffee, right? I may call him Jehovah Coffee as an expression of, he's my energy. He's my pick-me-up. He's my boost, right? And it's great to have a revelation about who God is, but that's secondary. Primary is God giving us a revelation about who God is. In English, when we read the Bible, most of us in here, we're reading it in the language of English, right? But English is not the original language the Bible was written in. I'm getting somewhere. So the majority of the Bible, all of the Old Testament, is written in a language called Hebrew. And then the New Testament is primarily written in Greek, a little bit of a language called Aramaic. The reason why I'm sharing this is because when we get to Genesis chapter 1, and we open the Bible, y'all work with me, okay? I've been studying, so I need y'all to connect with me. When we read in the Bible, we open in our English Bible, we open up the Bible, it'll say, in the beginning, God. So it's going to use an English word, God. I'm not saying it's a problem, but it doesn't give the full revelation of who God is. Because we have minimized and reduced some of the language. So it doesn't give us the fullness of what God is communicating to us about who God is. Because we use the word God very generically. But in the Hebrew, for example, if we're talking about the Old Testament, you'll see the name of God revealed in using different words depending on what God wants to communicate to us about God. So actually, when you open Genesis chapter 1, in Hebrew it says, well, I'm going to say the English in the beginning. In the beginning was Elohim. It doesn't say God, it says Elohim. We translate Elohim to God, but I want you guys to know what Elohim means. I'm getting somewhere. Somebody say, I'm built for this. I'm built for this. By the time we're done with today's sermon or service or lesson, I want you to walk away with that word in your mind. I am built for this. It's going to make sense. So Elohim shows up on the scene, or at least what we know as the first written or oral communication about who God is in Genesis, shows up on the scene. He says, in the beginning, Elohim. Elohim means supreme one or mighty one, with the emphasis on God's power and God's might. God could have showed up and introduced himself or God's up anyway, right? He could have used any word to communicate, because God is so multifaceted that God could have used any descriptor of God's self to communicate something about who he wanted to introduce himself as. And he shows up in Genesis chapter 1 and introduces himself first as Elohim. I'm supreme. I'm mighty one. And some of y'all say to me, Liana, I know this already, but just work with me, okay? Say it with me, I'm built for this. I'm built for this. So he shows up in Genesis chapter 1 and he says, in the beginning, God created. And most of us know, I don't want to assume that everybody, but most of us know the creation story, right? So in the creation story, Genesis chapter 1 through chapter 2, God is establishing. God is forming. God is creating. God is orchestrating. God is authoring, right? Let me read a little bit. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters. You're like, Liana, I know this, but roll with me. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. Then God said, let there be light. And there was light. Or in Hebrew, and then Elohim, the supreme one, saw there was darkness covering the earth, right? And then Elohim, the supreme one, said, let there be light. And then there was light, and it was good. Then he separated the light from the darkness, and Elohim, the supreme one, called the light day and the darkness night. And evening passed, and morning came, marking the first day. Then Elohim, the supreme one, said, let there be a space in between the waters. God recognizes there's an issue, and he does something about it. Come on. The supreme one says, let there be space between the waters to separate the waters of the heavens from the earth. And then, because he said it, verse 7 said, it happened. Y'all not rolling with me. Y'all not rolling with me. Then Elohim, the supreme one, said, make this space to separate the waters from the earth and the waters from the heaven. And Elohim, the supreme one, called the space sky. And evening passed and morning came, marking the second day. And I can go on and on and on how God creates vegetation and God creates animals and he multiplies the animals and how God separates the land from the water. He separates the heavenly skies from the earthly skies. He makes various kinds of birds, and then there's ponds and he puts fish in the pond, and on and on and on. And we're so used to this story that it loses its power. It loses its essence. We read so quickly through it, and we're so common, and we feel so associated with the text that that we don't let the text speak to us again. But today, God told me to tell you, you built for this. And you're talking about, Liana, what are you talking about? So God makes all these things, light, day, animal, vegetation, all this stuff. He speaks it into existence, and then it's so. And he calls it good. Then we get to what Deacon Glover read earlier, which is verse 26. If you got your Bible on your phone, on your tablet, in your lap, you got paper Bible, go to verse 26. I'm almost done. Y'all don't believe me, but I am. It says, then God, Elohim, the Supreme One, the Mighty One, after he makes everything else. In verse 26, it says, then God said to God's self, then Elohim said to himself, let us make human beings how? In our image to what? To be like us. There will reign over the fish in the sea and the birds in the sky. I'm not going to read the whole text, but essentially, we hear this scripture a lot of times, and it says, I'm made in the image of God, and that's true. It is very true that you're made in the image of God. But it's even more important, the revelation of how God revealed himself in Genesis was a direct reflection of how God created you. So God doesn't just say, let us make man in our image. Elohim, the Supreme One, says, let us make man in the Elohimness of who I am. Y'all not rolling with me. So when he makes humans, he steps aside and says, there's something about the supremacy of who I am that I want to fashion and bake and create and birth and breathe and into the essence of this next thing I'm gonna make. God says, let us make man in our image. And if the revelation that we have about God in Genesis 1, because it's still calling him Elohim at this point, is that God is supreme, and that God is mighty, and that God has authority, and that God reigns, it is a fair conclusion that when he made humans, he took that aspect of himself and he birthed it into you and me. Somebody say, I am built for this. So what we are to learn about who we are, we find in Genesis chapter 1. By the revelation of who God is. See, a lot of times we read Genesis chapter 1, which is good about God. But how often do we read it to learn something about ourselves? I'm built for this. When God made man, he said, I'm making them in my Elohimness. I'm making them supreme. I'm making them with authority. I'm making them with a particular type of ability in the earth. Y'all not feeling me? So in order to find some things out about yourself, you have to go back and read some things about God in Genesis chapter 1. What do we find out about God in Genesis chapter 1? God introduces God's self both in word and in action. I'm going to keep going. God had the power to initiate a beginning point. He looks at the earth and decides, I'm going to start something. God has the power to speak, and when God speaks, it is so. Y'all not feeling me? See, y'all, it's okay to understand this about God, but I want you to understand this about you. Because he said he made you in his image, right? It's, y'all got me sweating up here. Y'all better walk out of here believing that you are made in the Elohimness of God. God had the power to speak. It says God understood the power of his word. And when he can look into the situation, I'm going to slow down, that appears empty and lifeless. By the power of his tongue, he speaks into existence that which was not previously there. I'm going to keep going. God is a strategist and a problem solver, right? He's the master strategist. He steps back. He says, well, the land and the water can't flow together. I got to have night from day. There has to be animals, and animals of various kinds. God looks at a circumstance. Y'all about to work. I'm going to work myself up. God looks at a circumstance, and instead of just meditating on a problem, he does something about it. And then he steps back and says, I'm going to make you like that. God is creative, right? He doesn't make animals of every kind that are exactly the same. No, he didn't just make one. What God takes his creative nature and his creative ability, and he puts it inside of you and me, and he says, do something with it. God doesn't force us to be creative. He doesn't make things on our behalf. He puts creative abilities on the inside of us. And he says, I made them in my supremacy. I made them with the power to make something out of what seems to be nothing. Use your mind. That's just the imagination. Thank you, Maya. I got some. I just ain't used it yet. Use your imagination to dream up possibilities because he made you like that. To not be limited in your thinking. God was thoughtful and intentional. You know, he gets down to human beings and he doesn't just speak them into existence. He's like, I'm going to do something different here. He gets down in the dirt and out of the dust of the earth. He gets involved in his own creation and he produces you and I in his image. And what God is showing me is, Liana, and that's just my revelation from Genesis 1. You may go into Genesis 1 and get even more revelation about the activity of God. But what God is showing me is that the more that you see me, the more that you see you. Amen. We are not God. Let me make that real clear. Because, you know, we live in a culture that be like, we all God. But we're made like God. We're made with Godness. In us, God decided that he wanted a reflection of himself in the earth, and he made you and he made me. And so as we're looking around in our situations and our circumstances in our lives, we have to ask ourselves, am I living like I'm supreme? Am I living like I was made to reign? Or am I surrendering to my circumstances, or are my circumstances surrendering to me? God looked into nothingness. Psalms chapter 8, verses 4 through 5 says, what are mere mortals that you should think about them? Human beings that you should care for them, right? And we tend to stay there like, oh, who am I that God should care for me? No, but then the next part says, yet you made them a little lower than God. And you crowned them with glory and honor. God made you like himself, not just to sit on it, but to do something with it. You built for this. Psalms 139, 13, 14 says, you made all the delicate inner parts of my body and knit me together in my mother's womb. Thank you for making me so what? Wonderfully complex. Your workmanship is marvelous. How well I know it. When's the last time you looked in the mirror and said, God, your workmanship is marvelous? And not just from, but if God's workmanship is marvelous, what am I doing with God's workmanship? How am I viewing God's workmanship? Am I living with the type of authority that says I'm God's workmanship? Am I showing up in my family, in my communities, at work, in the circumstances of everyday life with an attitude that says, God, your workmanship? You did something good here. I forgot he said, when he made everything else, he said was good, and he made man, he said it was very good. God's giving you the power to initiate, right? God began something. We're never stuck. If the same power that God had, he put inside of us, no matter what the circumstances are in our lives, you have the power to initiate something new. The Bible says life and death are in the power of the, we say it, but do we live like it? But let me tell you something. Oh, it says life and death are in the power of the tongue. So whatever you're saying is what you're manifesting. What are you saying about your situation? What are you saying about your abilities? What are you saying about your makeup, Liana? What are you saying about God's workmanship? God made you a problem solver and a strategist. Are you looking at what seems to be empty and void and just discouraged by it? Are you speaking life into it? Are you becoming creative with what's in your hand? He said to Moses, what's in your hand? Are you trusting what God has given you? Are you intentional? There's a scripture that says, Lord, bless the work of my hands. Have you asked God to bless the work of your hands lately? Not just your hand, your mind, your abilities, your thought process. When's the last time you said, God, bless this so that I can be all that you've called me to be in the earth? What are you doing with your supremacy? Are you sitting on it? Are you living like it? I'm almost done. This is the last, I promise. Ephesians 3:20 says this, and we quote this bad boy. We quote it. But we misquote it. Because we like to say, you know, unto him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all. And we ask for things. We like to say that. But that's not what the scripture says. The scripture says, now all glory to God who is able through his mighty power at work within us to accomplish infinitely more than we ask or think. We like to pray, God, accomplish more than I can ask or think. He said, no, it's according to the power of God that is at work within you. When's the last time you asked God to bless the power that is at work within you? Because if it's within you, it got to come out of you. If it's within you, then you have to be an active participant in the process. He says, power at work within us for what purpose? To accomplish. There's no purpose for power if it's not associated with an accomplishment. What has God called you to accomplish in the earth? The power is there because he said it in Genesis. I made you in the Elohimness of who I am. I've made you supreme. I've made you to reign. But there can be a truth that we're not living in. Something can be true and we don't believe it. Because this is how you can this could be your litmus. And I promise you I'm done. This could be your litmus. Am I living to my highest potential? It's keeping, Liana is not living to her high. Are you living to your highest potential? Because honestly, that is a form of worship in and of itself. And at any point we're living below our highest potential, we're telling God his workmanship is not good. It's a slap in the face to the one who decided to put his image in us in the first place. But this is a word of encouragement to us. The Bible says, as a man thinketh, as a person thinketh, so shall that be. A lot of us there's this disconnect between our performance, our accomplishment, and who we are, already are, because God created us that way. There's a disconnect because we don't believe it. The Bible says, as you thinketh, so you shall be. It's true about who you are, but as long as you're thinking is substandard, as long as our thinking is not in congruence with who God says we are, we will constantly live below the standard God made us. He said a little bit lower than God, a little bit lower than the angels. I don't know about you, but I ain't been living a little bit lower than the angel. I've been living a lot lower than the angel. You know what I'm saying? And it was a wake-up call. It was a challenge to rise to the occasion, which is why Paul tells us in Romans to constantly be transformed by the renewing of our mind. Transformation is not a one-time effect. It's an ongoing process. It's a daily battle. The world we live in, the conditions of our society, our communities, images on TV, images on social media, the voice of the devil and his imps, they're constantly trying to get us to think below the truth of what God says. And if we ever get to a point where we're operating from a frequency that is in line with the Elohimness of who we are, we would be unstoppable. Our communities, our families, everything. And so my prayer this morning is for the person that says, I ain't been living like Elohimness. I made that word up, yes, don't Google that. But I'm not living like Elohimness is on the inside of me. And today I want to renew my mind. First of all, you got to get in God's word. You don't know what God says about you unless you know what God says about you, right? And then the Bible also tells us that Listen, you can't just open the book. It takes the Holy Spirit to reveal truth to us. So even as we open the book, it becomes an opportunity to pray, God, show me in your word. Show me how you want me to live. Show me who I'm supposed to be. Show me what, now take this word and make it make sense. Show me how to apply it to my everyday circumstances. Where am I living below my authority? Where am I living with bitterness and unforgiveness? Where am I lazy and procrastinating? Where am I not seeing hope and purpose and possibilities for myself? Where have I allowed the lies of this world and images in society to tell me who I can be? Reveal that to me. So that I can pull down and cast down the lies of the enemy, and I can rise to be who you've called me to be. I can live in the Elohimness because you said you made me in my image, in your image. The Supreme One. God introduces himself as Supreme Reigner, and then he says, you like that too. And if you're like, hey, I would like for you to pray for me because I want to be elevated and my belief about who God says that I am, so I can accomplish what God has called me to accomplish according to the power that's at work inside of me. If that's you, meet me down here at the altar. I would like to pray for us. I would like to pray for you. I would like to encourage us to level up because I'm built for this. Because you're built for this. You don't have to orchestrate it. You don't have to manufacture it. God said, I baked it into your very existence. God said, I made you that way. You don't have to try to figure it out. You got to tap in. You got to allow the power that's at work within you to show up through you. Thank you, God. God, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you so much. That even in the midst of grief and hard times, God, you said there's still a work to be accomplished. You called your sons and your daughters to rise in power. You've called your sons and your daughters to reign with authority, God. So I cast down every lie of the enemy this morning. Your word tells us to pull down and to cast down those strongholds and any thought that would elevate itself above the knowledge of God. Any lie that elevates itself or attempts to above the knowledge of God and who God says we are, we cast that down today. By the power of Jesus Christ, I pray that we walk out of here in authority, God. I thank you for the vulnerability it takes to even come down here, God. The courage it takes to step out, because that's what it takes, God. Make your word alive in us, Jesus, today, so that all of us can begin to take dominion in the reins of influence that you have called us to. May we not shrink because it seems so big, but may we rise above it knowing that the power of the Holy Ghost goes with us. We thank you this morning, Jesus. In your son's name we pray. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. Amen. Clap it up. Clap it up. And I would not be doing what God calls us to do if I didn't do this. Maybe you came here today and you don't even know this Jesus that I'm talking about. But you're saying, hey, I want that power. I want to live with that authority. That authority comes through relationship with Jesus Christ, with surrender to God. If you're saying, you know what, I want to surrender my life to Christ today, yeah, you can go say if you came for prayer, amen. But if you want to come down here and give your life to Christ today, there's no better day. That you know that you and God are rolling, that you have surrendered your life to Jesus and you have accepted him as your Lord and Savior. If you haven't done it and you want to do it, the Bible says, on the day that you hear my voice, harden not your heart. And maybe God's talking to you through my voice this morning. Or maybe you hear a still small voice in your ear saying, today's your day. Go. Don't be afraid. If that's you, we're here to support you. Anybody? Cool. That's great. And does anybody want to join the Sunnyside family? Maybe you don't have a church home. You don't have a community to support you and to journey with you and to walk with you. I was saying this in discipleship class this morning. We stronger together. And you would like to make Sunnyside your church home. Today's a good day to join the family. Nope. Okay. Amen. Amen.
That was good. Amen. Amen. Built for this. Take it, if you were a car, what kind of car would you be? Would you be a jalopy? Or would you be a Tesla? New, different, on the road for Jesus. Thank you. This morning, I thank you, Sister Liana. Beautiful word. Beautiful word. Beautiful word. And, you know, the Spirit always preaches. The Spirit falls in line. That one preacher will preach, and it'll be something that the next preacher will pick up, and they don't even know what they're doing. What was the theme of our camp? What was the theme of our camp? If you don't know, read his shirt. Read Tyler's shirt. What does it say? Image Village. We are Elohimness. See, little Tyler, when I first met little Tyler, Tyler told me he wanted to be a gang member. That was his highest goal, so he can get a gun. Didn't you say it? Yes. Now he's in church on the camera. See, we ain't about just having church no more here on this corner. No, we gonna do some things through the Spirit of God. Through the Elohimness that's within us. Let me tell you what happened this week. Spirit of Shirley, see. See, they would travel. We got to see how far they travel every Sunday. We should be paying them. And they were regular. Used to be Thursday night, Saturday. Sunday? Right. Right. Elohimness. Right. You know, we're having, I was real concerned because we're losing $4,000 a month because VOA is leaving. And this church was dependent on that money. And I preached that for 3 weeks, I kept saying. And then finally I gave up and said, Elohim? I did. They want to sell chicken dinners. Elohim, we can't sell $4,000 worth of chicken dinners a month. And Elohim did exceedingly, abundantly, above what I could ask or think. He got the county of Los Angeles to get in touch with me. Program we're running here through Heart and Soul right next door. And said, what we will do because of what you're doing, we will hire anybody that comes to you and pay them $20 an hour,35 hours. Thank you so much. I'm getting real carried away here because you don't know what that means. You see, here too before, Sunnyside was playing all the camera people, the people in the booth and everything. Now, the county of Los Angeles. Yo, you don't hear me. We don't have to pay that money no more. That God will do exceedingly and abundantly above what you have. God is real.
God is real.
God is real. Are you real? What are you built for? What you gonna do with God? Let him walk with you and talk with you. You can do something. What are you built for? Oh, you Cadillac, you. God can do. And I have some brothers back there that I want to introduce. Aaron, let me run on back here. Aaron, I need you to introduce yourself, boy.
Hi, good morning, church. My name is Aaron Wilson. And I'm a lead ICMS case manager with PATH. And just happened to, well, I had on the calendar to come to the food giveaway this month, and I ended up putting the wrong date. I showed up yesterday, and I passed by here, and I didn't see anybody, but I seen the gate open. And I said, well, I had something else to do. I circled around and came back and pulled up into the parking lot, and I seen the pastor. I had actually recognized him from, I was here last Sunday. But I don't know, it was by God that we ended up meeting, because we ended up having a long conversation. We have a lot in common. But he did mention a new program that he was trying to put in place. And he told me that he may use my help on the case management side of the program he's putting together. He did mention that I wanted to make sure I'd be here, because he told me the young lady that just preached was doing the case management, trying to put things in place. She could use a little bit of help. I don't know, it just seemed like everything seemed to fall in place yesterday. As we was in that parking lot talking and having so much in common. So I'm looking forward. So like I said, see how God could use me, Elohimness, in this situation.
Amen. Let me make it a little bit more plain. He, caseworker, he deals with homeless people on Skid Row. And what did you call it? The crucial, what? ICMS, which means intense homeless. We're trying to do a program here, Leon. And I just thought that maybe you and him could talk. That maybe Elohim created something yesterday that he was supposed to miss the day he missed, so that we can meet in the parking lot, so I can introduce him to you, so that our program that opens on the 31st of this month, that's next week. See, it's one thing to preach a sermon, but when it becomes real, and we gotta start being real, saints. There's a lot of darkness out here. But in the darkness, he says, speak to it. Speak to it. And I'm back to the dedication of my sister. She kept coming. They wanted to buy a house, and this was too far. But she kept coming. She spoke in the darkness and still speaking. Lord, let's give Shirley and the Lord and God a holy hand clap. Jesus' name. Amen. Now, yeah, you can keep standing. We're dismissing. Come on up, sis. Ed, I saw you back there. I saw you yesterday coming to choir rehearsal. So we got a new choir member, y'all. Amen.
God, we just thank you for this day. Your word says even the darkness is light to you, God. And so we thank you for that this morning. We pray strength, comfort, God. We pray that we would walk into this week acting like Elohim made us in his image. God, cover us, keep us, protect us, and bring us back here with songs of worship and praise for how you did it. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. See you all next week. See you all next week.
Greet your neighbor. Shake hands with somebody. Tell them you love them. Come on.